Hi, everyone. I'm not talking about virtual reality today, but something else. And I have a disclosure. So placebo pills are placebo dissolutions. So I'm not here to talk about placebo pills, but something different about the reality of pain, the neurobiology of placebo effects. And to understand why that is important, I would like to remind why the epidemic of opioids is so critical. And we need to pay attention to some numbers that fortunately are coming out. So first, 55% of people, many in this room, suffer from chronic pain, persistent pain that make their life miserable, interfere with daily activity. So why do we care about pain? We all wish a pain-free world, but this is not the reality. Pain can be physical, emotional, and both. So since 1999, we observe an increase in prescription of opioids. So we have numbers like prescription of opioids quadruplate. By 2010, 200 million prescription of opioids in the States have been raised. Moreover, one out of five patients with no chronic pain, no cancer pain, receive a prescription of opioids. 2 million Americans were abusers of opioids in 2014. And another big number, a recent study looking at 36,000 patients, pain-free, they went to surgery, either elective, major or minor surgery. Later, after surgery, 6,000 were opioid users. So we are talking about patients who were pain-free. They went to the ER, they went through surgery, they received a prescription of opioids, and they become persistent opioid users. Persistent opioid users means risk of dying for opioids. And indeed, with the escalation of opioids prescription, often without a strong rationale, just with this wish to please the patient to be pain-free, raise the toll of deaths. So the toll of deaths last year was 72,000 people died from prescription of opioids. From 1999 to 2015, 108 million of Americans died because of opioids prescribed to treat pain. And we are talking about young people who went for a wisdom tooth removal. They were pain-free, they were full of dreams. They died because of opioids prescribed by physicians that wanted to make them for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 3 days pain-free. So this is the way we treat pain today. We need a shift, and I'm here to tell you, not the solution, but at least part of our research, our scope, that starts with learning more about the reality of pain. So I start with the sound of a neuron spike. I was a young PhD student in neuroscience, fresh after my MD, and my dream was to do something to make the health of people better. So with this interest, after practicing medicine for a short period, because I realized that I like more to be engaged in new knowledge and discover something that can be translated from lab to humans and healthcare. So I was doing placebo effects. And I was quite skeptical. What is placebo? What are placebo effects? And I told my mentor, I want to do something serious, something that is not psychology, rather embedded in medicine. Well, I started to work in surgery room as a neurophysiologist to try to understand how neurons can change their spike when we provide placebos. So we gave patient with Parkinson, apomorphine, that is a drug to release rigidity, tremor, and the symptoms that accompany Parkinson. And this patient were in the surgery room and were receiving a placebo after apomorphine, starts to feel better. And they were telling us, I feel better. I feel like the other day when I received apomorphine. This spike of neurons, this discharge, the sound, was so fascinating and changed my path, changed my career. So I started to want to know how the sending modulator systems in our brain can make us perceive less rigidity, less tremor, less pain. And pain is a fascinating topic. So we can study pain towards a very complex array. And today we know that pain is a signal when we experience something that is injuring us, helping us to move back, protect us. And this is acute pain, something that has a defensive value from an evolutionary point of view. However, when we have pain every day, the reality changes. This makes life difficult. This interferes with life. So we know that this beautiful signal that eventually, from an evolutionary point of view, we develop to protect ourselves can make our life miserable. So how can we deal with that? A nice strategy is to learn more about the resource of our brain to reduce pain. We can reduce pain towards placebo effects and expectations. So every time we use a treatment, it can be a pharmacological treatment, even an opioid, but also a surgical treatment or complementary and integrative treatment, we have an expectancy. We expect to feel better, but sometimes also we are skeptical and we may have a negative expectation. These expectations can create an array of responses in the brain. The brain becomes so powerful to be able to inhibit pain. And today we know, towards many beautiful studies, that there is a chain of events in the brain allow us to inhibit in a natural way this signal. So every time we expect to feel better, we release in the brain what we call endogenous opioids. Yes, the same words, endogenous opioids. They are very similar. And indeed, we create pharmacological opioids by learning from plants, but also by learning about the neurobiology and the ability to release endorphin in the brain. Based on that, we are really hoping to develop new creative strategy, and placebo can be part of this solution. How do we start? Well, if we decide to provide placebos, sugar pills, talc pills, we have some medical constraints, and also people may be skeptical. Come on, Luana, you can't give a placebo to release pain. However, we can do like the apomorphine plus a placebo. We can provide active treatments, for example, opioids that we may need in the ER or for a short time, together with placebo. And this can allow the body to mimic the same action of the drug. This has been shown for immune system, apomorphine system, as dopamine system, as well as many other systems. Another opportunity is to open label placebo. We can be straightforward placebo pills. I start with a package of placebo pills. And indeed, it has been shown that if patients, for example, with IBS, with low back pain, were prescribed placebos, and they knew that they were receiving placebo, their outcome for pain improved. So eventually we need this action. Sometimes we depend on taking a pill. So if that is a dependence of taking a pill, why not? Let's give open label placebo pills. And I'm even more simple because there are other solutions that do not even require a pill. We can communicate and inform a patient that pain can be managed by mindset. So I mentioned to you the expectations. The most powerful way to manage expectation is to choose the right words and educate your patients, your colleagues, clinicians, about the possibility to create new framework around pain medicine. For example, if we provide a drug or we provide an intervention and we anticipate you are going to feel a big sting, even the anticipation of feeling more pain, of experiencing an increase of pain, can make these people feeling more pain. So why don't we change words? Why don't we find a framing that can help everyone to relieve pain with a positive expectations? Yes, yes, we do need to say all the truth, and I do agree, and I work on bioethics for that. But there is a balance between say all the truth and prevent people from feeling more pain. So we have this beautiful resource, our brain, and our brain needs to be known. If we understand that the descending pain modulator system, the endogenous opioid system, can modulate pain, then it's time to change the way we educate physicians, nurses, clinicians. Let them learn about this system and how can they translate this system into clinical practice. Another possibility is just to use the right words every time we have any treatment. So if you are going to take opioids, be cautious. Limit this use of opioids to the very minimum necessary. If you need a surgery, be aware that even people who receive sham surgery get better. If you use complementary and integrative medicine, know that the ritual around this treatment is part of the most powerful component. So you don't need to take placebo pills. Rather, we need to have a shift in education about pain. It's also true that not everyone responds to placebo at the same way. We know that some people respond very well, some other people do not respond. Some people activate this beautiful descending pain modulator system effectively, some other people do not do. This is still an open question for scientists. Probably genetics, cultural elements, psychology work together to make people what we call placebo responder or placebo responder status. But still, for those, if it's 35% of people that can benefit from harnessing the descending pain modulator system, why not? We should do that. So my message is, every time we are in pain, don't just wish a pain-free world. That is not the reality. Be cautious. Be cautious and look forward. There are misunderstandings in medicine, and probably pain medicine is one of the areas where we fail over the last 50 years. The escalation of people who die from prescription of opioids is a sign for us to discover new strategies, to champion new pain education for our future students. And why not be brave and use new mechanisms, new therapeutic strategies that eventually can help to cope with pain, improve life, and minimize pain interference. Thank you.